Another great, happy gospel story. We have had a string of them, but in spite of all the talk of eternal damnation and fire and so forth, this is a story of good news. It is a story of good news for those who are the sick, the hungry, those that are in prison or alone, those who are strangers, which is kind of biblical language for immigrants and foreigners. It is good news to them because what this parable tells us is that God is with them in the midst of their suffering, in the midst of their loss, in the midst of their need. It's also good news for us when we're not those. I mean, the notion of accountability and judgment is a bit, how do I say it, terrifying. But the good news is that we know what we're going to be asked. I mean, think about back in the sort of days of college or school, our biggest sort of fear and anxiety was not knowing what the teacher was going to ask us. And so going into that exam thinking, gosh, not only do I hope I know something, but I hope I know the right thing. And Jesus is laying out for us in these parables what it is that God is going to ask us when God asks us to give an account of our life, when we will be judged by God for the things that we did and the things that we failed to do. The questions will be, so did you feed the hungry? Did you give drink to those who were thirsty? Did you visit those who were in sick or in prison? How did you treat the stranger or the immigrant? Now, in this notion of accountability or testing, we need to understand that there are multiple layers. Today is Christ the King Sunday. That's why we are in white. It is the last Sunday of the church year. In that sense, the ultimate Sunday in this year-long season in which we proclaim our understanding as Christ is King, and not simply King in the sense of leader, but as it says in our collect of the day or in the Hallelujah chorus, Christ the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Christ is King over us as individuals. As I said, we will need to give an individual accounting of what we did with our, thinking of last week, our talents, our financial and non-financial resources. How did we use them to give aid and comfort to those who were in need? How did we share them with others, or did we just treat ourselves as the ultimate consumer? But in the sense of Christ as King of Kings, we also need to understand that in real time, God judges institutions and countries. I spent the last 9 years as Canon of the Ordinary in the Diocese of Ohio, and I worked with congregations where clergy and congregation either abused the trust in the sense of the leadership, abused the trust that was given to them and stopped doing these things, or where even the whole congregation stopped doing these things, became completely inwardly focused, disconnecting from the communities around them. And when that happened, at best, there was a congregation in disarray and struggling and soul-searching and losing members. And at its ultimate place, I would find myself standing in sometimes a church larger than this that was empty and about to be sold. Let's not forget that God not only asks and judges those of us individually, but as a community of faith. And that judgment of God is not only about individuals and about churches and organizations, it is also about civil societies. It is about countries. Read the first 40 chapters of the book of Isaiah, and you will see the nation, the people of Israel, going through a long and repeated cycle of being faithful to God, doing these things spoken of in Matthew 25, and all is good. And then turning their back on God, turning their back on one another, and God allowing them to fall into disarray to that point when they became repentant of their ways, remembered who they are, remembered their relationship with God, remembered their relationship with one another, sought God's help and God's blessing, and God welcomed them back. This ongoing judgment of Israel happens again and again and again. It goes through so many cycles that when I was teaching a Bible study on it, when I was first ordained, we got somewhere towards the latter part of that, and I looked up at the ladies in the Bible study and I said, I don't know what to say. We've gone through this territory already so many times. It's the same thing again. God, as we understand through Scripture, stands as judge and king over not only the people of Israel, but all peoples, all nations. And that is not limited by time. That is true today. God is King of King and Lord of Lords, stands as King of King and Lord of Lords over the state of Illinois and the country of the United States. What God asks and expects, as communicated in Matthew 25, applies to us in our civil actions. Now, God is the ultimate nonpartisan being. God doesn't care how we get there. So taking the issue of hunger, for instance, right now the USDA reports that there are 15.8 million people under the age of 18 who live in households where they are unable to consistently access enough nutritious food necessary for a healthy life. The Illinois Commission to End Hunger reports this year that 1.8 million residents of this state are food insecure, meaning that they are unsure of where or when they will receive their next meal. In short, one in seven Illinois residents, 14%, is at risk of hunger. Further, hunger disproportionately affects children. The data from Feeding America shows that 662,000 children in Illinois are food insecure. That's more than one in five. God doesn't care about what particular public policy decision is made to resolve this matter. And God doesn't care at one level whether it comes through public policy or corporations paying a just living wage or individuals who contribute to food pantries or individual giving money to someone on the street or who crosses their path. But what God will do is hold you and I individually, as a church and as a state and as a country, accountable for the fact that we have this many people who are hungry. Because what God is saying in this passage is that not only are these people hungry, but when God says, I am them and they are me, what God is saying is God is hungry for us to feed. You and I need to not fall into the trap of compartmentalizing our faith so much to say that as long as I contribute here at Church of the Holy Spirit in some way to the food pantry or to our community meals in Waukegan, that we've checked the box and we're done. Going back to last week, God is going to ask us what we've done with all of our talents. How have we used those talents to feed those who are hungry, and not just children, but of all ages? How have you and I used our talents to ensure that all in this state and this country have access to health care? How do we, who, unless you're 100% Native American, all of us or our ancestors were an immigrant at one time, how do we use our talents to care for both, not only those who are immigrants here, but perhaps even to make different, again, business decisions, public policy decisions, and individual decisions such that the economies in other countries might be strong enough that mothers don't have to send their children away thousands of miles, trusting them to a smuggler in hopes that their teenager might arrive in the United States and find a job. How bad and how desperate must life be when that seems the best and is the most reasonable option? Now, I know that these are hugely seeming in many ways really insurmountable problems. Jesus himself said, you will always have the poor with you. We're not going to do away with it completely. But we cannot allow our inability to wipe something completely away to stop us from making a difference. We may not make it possible for all 662,000 children who currently do not have dependable meals in Illinois to have food. But how many might we be able to feed that we are not already feeding? And the thing to understand in all of these categories, again, part of the good news for us, it's not only about what God expects of us, what God is asking us to do, but to remember that God has given us the talents so that we can make a difference. We have the opportunity. We are empowered to transform this world. Because it's not only the talents themselves that God has given us, but God has given us God's own Spirit to work through us. The miracle of the fishes and the loaves did not end when Jesus broke the bread all those years ago. And when you and I find the will and the strength to share what we have, to feed the poor, to clothe the naked, and to visit those who are sick and in prison, when we reach out to the least amongst us, as the parable says, we meet God. For what we do to and with the least, we are doing to and with God. We have the opportunity to use our gifts, to use our talents, to not only transform this society, but to meet God. And that is an opportunity for us not to waste. Amen.